The following is an LCTV sports presentation. Lincoln College basketball on LCTV is made possible by Grau Chevrolet Buick in Lincoln, ME Realty, and by the State Bank of Lincoln.
Welcome inside the Jack D. Nutt Arena for game number two here at this afternoon. It's been a great day. We've already seen one Lynx win. Hopefully to make it to Adam Hoffman, Nick Jackson with you here back on the broadcast as usual. Feels so good to be back, Adam. We're seeing this Lynx team come in after another tough loss against the 10th ranked IU Kokomo in that ball game on the road. And just when I thought it couldn't get any worse from Belleville, that game, it got worse.
That game was horrendous. I mean, I've never seen us probably shoot that bad. We were 9 for 31 from 3. That's a number right there. I mean, wow, that was a horrible game. I've never seen that team play that bad. The last time I could remember was when we played Parkland back my freshman year, and we were at Parkland, and we got blown out of that ball game when we thought we would come in there and win, and we came in the same way to Kokomo. I mean, we were just too confident, and it just wasn't working, and just nothing was going right for us.
And you mentioned it. We talked about it on the bus. This was a team that had no size. We actually had the advantage, which was surprisingly on the defensive side of things. We ended up losing only by 9, 73-64, to a game that got close down the stretch. So what happened in that second half that you see the Lynx can improve on and take to Graceland here tonight?
I mean, we were down 25 at one time, and somehow we came back and got it to 9. I don't know how, but we were right in at the end. We were shooting good. I mean, Junior hit a shot in the corner to cut it to within 9, and then just like that, we just kind of stopped trying after that. So it was kind of weird, but I think Junior has to have a better game. You know, he only had 13 points in that loss against Kokomo. He's been over 17 all year, so him and Trayvon really have to lead this team. He had 25 in that ball game, but it's just too little.
Now you mentioned it right there. Trayvon led the way with 25 points, 4 rebounds. One thing I wanted to point out on the stat sheet, 1 assist. This man comes in averaging about 6 assists per contest from him, and it starts with him. I think it's step up. I mean, you look at the team stats, we only had 4 assists all ball game. So I think it starts with Trayvon Tyler. He gets the pace moving a little bit. He finds the open man, and somebody like Junior, Tez, Montez Crumble, Martin, they all can knock down some shots, maybe even Tyrone Wright, throw him into the mix. So I'd love to see that play out down the stretch. It was more of a lot of one-on-one play, you would have to agree.
It was a lot of catch, you know, dribble, 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 step back, mid-range jumper. That was the whole first half, and we didn't make any of them. So, I mean, it was a bad game for us.
Now, let's get to this game here tonight because the Lynx trying to redeem themselves coming off of 2 straight losses, 2 against ranked opponents, though, 1-2 in ranked play. However, though, they're trying to get things back on track with the team they've already beaten once this season, and that is the Graceland Yellow Jackets, who come in 1-2 on the season. Your Lynx 3-2 on the year. But as I mentioned, that was a game that we saw our actually first game of the year, both teams' first game of the year. So never know what you were going to quite see, and the Lynx blew it open early in that first half, led 41-20 at halftime. But the second half, Adam, that was a completely different story, only winning 75-68.
Yeah, we held Virgil Walker Jr. to 3 points in that first half. He's by far their main scorer, you know, coming in averaging 22 points and 10 rebounds a game. Held him to 3, and he had 3 fouls as well. And then in the second half, I believe he scored 20 in that second half. They just kept force feeding him the ball, and he was just too big, too strong for anyone that we threw at him.
No, you're exactly right. Did have 20 in that second half, finished with 23. Good news, though, in that ball game, which we thought was going to be a good sign to come for that Lynx team, was 4 out of the 5 starters were in double figures. You gotta like what you saw there. Trayvon Tyler led the way with 21, followed by Latwan Porter, who we probably won't see here tonight. He had 12. Darnell Latham Jr. had 18 in that ball game. but only shot one of seven from behind the arc. So going to look for him to get some better open looks. 9 of 11 from the free throw line for Junior. Along with Martin, he had 10 coming off the bench, and Crumble had 7. So I look for these guys to kind of step up in a much-needed role here today. Adam, what are you going for as some of these factors in tonight's game?
I think we got to control the glass. I think that's the biggest thing. You know, we cannot allow Nuku Ibe and Walker Jr. just kind of walk all over us on the glass. Tyrone has to play big out there. He went against a 7-footer earlier this year and absolutely kind of dominated him. He was just, they had no option. They had no answer for Tyrone Wright, and then he just disappears in other games. So we don't know what's going on with Tyrone. Hopefully tonight he just shakes it off. This is a big matchup for him, so hopefully he comes out on top.
And the Lynx, however, in that ball game, gave up 48 points in that second half. This is a Lynx team that prides themselves on the defensive side of things. I mean, what? Coming in averaging 10, 11 steals per contest, top 20 in the nation in that category. No Laytuan Porter, though, but still enough guard threat to kind of maintain the defensive side of things. I mean, only allowed 21 points in that first half.
Yeah, I mean, without Laytuan Porter, he's one of the smartest defenders on our team. So without him, it's going to be a little difficult, but we've been getting along without him the last couple days, even though we have two straight losses without him in the lineup. So hopefully tonight, you know, Winslow Martin II comes through big for us in the starting lineup.
We'll see what happens here in game number two as the Lady Lynx won 85-72 in game number one. Don't go anywhere, though. Lynx action coming your way right here on LCTV.
/150/90, /180/111, /160/110.
I had a stroke.
This is what high blood pressure looks like. You might not feel its symptoms, but the results from a stroke are far from invisible or silent. If you've come off your treatment plan, get back on it, or talk with your doctor to create an exercise, diet, and medication plan that works for you. Go to loweryourhbp.org.
If I would have followed a treatment plan, I would not be in this situation.
If you love them enough to suck the snot out of their nose at 4 a.m., then surely you'll check nhtsa.gov/the right seat to make sure they're in the right car seat.
I don't remember how it started.
Start the day.
Our back and forth. It always came back. You probably don't remember what you told me.
That was perfect.
But I heard every word.
Look at you. You're at the top of your game. You're unstoppable. Nothing can throw you off track. Wait, is that your car? Uh-oh. Yeah, I saw that coming. That will throw you off track. You're looking at around 10 grand in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Let's try this again. Smart move. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
One in three adults has pre-diabetes. That means it could be you, your favorite brother, your other brother, you, your football buddy, your football buddy, you, your plumber.
Breathe right into your foot.
Your plumber's masseuse.
Yes.
You, your dog walker, your cat jogger. With early diagnosis, pre-diabetes can be reversed. Take the risk test at doihaveprediabetes.org.
Welcome back to Inside the Jack D. Nunner. We're working very quickly here in this one. As you can see, Graceland in the road navy blue uniforms. Lynx rocking those new white home openers here for this game. Adam, let's meet the starting lineups.
Yeah, for Graceland, a lot has changed since the last time we saw them. We got Nick Coleman. We got number 4, Doc Self. We got number 10, Ramon Franklin. Number 22, Virgo Walker Jr. And number 33, Orlando Gonzalez. And for the Lynx, really nothing has changed since last game. You got Winslow Martin II, the big man Tyrone Wright, and then the three guards in Latham Jr., Tyler, and Crumble as Wright wins the toss.
See what the Lynx can do here with their first possession of the first half. And looking for back-to-back wins here on Alumni Weekend. Lynx rocking the new white uniforms as Wright has it now to Crumble. Crumble trying to drive baseline, trying to kick it back out, instead stolen away by Graceland. Here they come now on the fast break. That's Self. Cross court pass to Coleman. One more inside to the corner for Franklin. You can't hit the three, but offensive rebound goes to Walker Jr., who's going to have to a key to watch in this contest. But Self from downtown, you already know, knocks it home. And Graceland on the board first.
Yeah, Doc Self came off the bench the first time we saw them, and he absolutely lit us up off the bench. So I'm curious to see if how much he's going to impact this ball game now in the starting lineup.
Self, he had 10 points in that game against us the first time, but Trayvon Tyler answers with a three of his own, and we're tied right back up at three.
That's just another great play. I mean, just got to get the shooters open, and Trayvon Tyler, our main scorer, and he's also going to take Walker Jr. That's an interesting matchup. I'm curious to see how that's going to play out.
And here come the Yellow Jackets back to the way. We spoiled their homecoming weekend. They're trying to spoil our alumni weekend right here with a win. But we'll see what Trayvon Tyler and this Lynx team have to do to answer as Gonzalez from downtown, no. Offensive rebound goes to Walker Jr., who didn't hit the backboard, so it'll stay with 1 second on the shot clock. But however, though, he was fouled, so they're going to get bailed out.
Yeah, it's going to be a 20-second shot clock now off the dead ball. So, yeah, like you said, just kind of sucks the air out of the building right there. We thought we got a stop right there, but just the opposite.
As Adam mentioned, they get a fresh 20 and the basketball right here. We're tied at three as it will be Self. Self guarded by Crumble. They're trying to post up Walker Jr. down low. Surprise, no help defense. He turns baseline. Right-hand hook, no good. Ball tipped out of bounds. It'll stay with the Yellow Jackets, but you got to like the defense early from Trayvon Tyler on Walker Jr. so far.
Yeah, I like that look. I can't believe that we have one of our smallest guys on the floor guarding their best big man, but I like having that just because the toughness of Trayvon Tyler is really going to disrupt Walker Jr., especially when he's out on the perimeter.
Franklin now with it, kicks it back out to Self. They're swinging around the perimeter here for Coleman, now down low to Walker. Here comes the double team with Wright, trying to put up another one with the right hand, no, too strong, tip back, no, by Franklin, and pulled down by Wright. Here come the Lynx on the other end. They got Junior in the corner. He's going to pop it from downtown. No. Awfully close, though. Wanted to see this man get started. This is a kid that can really shoot the basketball.
Yeah, he scored 32 in one of the wins over in Indiana Westland. I believe it was against IU East. He can just score the basketball better than most people out there. But he has to get off to a good start in order to play a really good game.
Coleman dishes it off to Franklin, who takes a mid-range jumper from the baseline. No. Into the hands of Junior. Junior going to thought about running and gun type mentality. Instead, he's going to set up the offense right here. Still no subs as we're tied at three in the first 3 minutes of this ball game. Martin trying to cross the court pass to Tyler, but nobody was home. And now Tyler going to pick up a foul as it was Coleman trying to run the floor. His first, team second here in this first half.
Yeah, not the best foul there, but you know he got what he wanted. He wanted to stop the fast break. So Trayvon Tyler, it's his first foul. Nothing really to worry about.
Graceland will inbound. It's 3-3 here. 17 minutes remain in half number one. Self with it. It's a screen instead. It should be an illegal screen going on Walker, and it will be. And that's a good start here for the Lynx. Even though he didn't do much, you still get an extra foul called right there.
Well, he really just stood there, and Crumble just stumbled over his foot. So I'm shocked that was called a foul, but that's good news for us. That's already his first foul really early into this ballgame.
Team's first as well. Still, after those big three-point shots, have not seen any offense so far from either side. We'll see if the Lynx can take the lead right here with the made basket. Right now to Crumble, swinging around the perimeter here for Martin, trying to find Tyler down low. Interesting, though, that Walker Jr. actually guards Martin on the defensive side of things. They feed Tyler. Tyler has it poked away, but we have a foul going against the Yellow Jackets, and I believe that's Coleman, who looks to be a little shaken up.
I believe he got hit below the belt.
Oh.
If I were to guess. Tyler was trying to get some space down low. He did apologize. You know, there's just, it's not his fault. It's not on purpose.
The crown jewels were at least a little bit damaged there on that one, and maybe bruised, as Tyler thought about a three from the parking lot, instead goes to crumble. 15 seconds now on the shot clock as they kick it back to Martin at the top of the key. Martin working on Walker, out to Wright. Wright trying to drive in, left side lane, puts it up, just a tad too strong. Again, Adam, you saw a little something there as Graceland pulls down the board?
Well, he hit the backboard super hard, which caused the ball to really ricochet off the rim. I don't see how, that's never called a goaltend. I don't know why he hits the backboard to the point where the ball really has no chance of going in.
And so, that foul going on Martin, he kind of reached in there on Walker Jr.'s, his first, team's third here in the first couple minutes. I think this is the quickest time we've gotten to three fouls in about 4 minutes in any game this season, as they find Gonzalez down low, and the Lynx basically just let him have it as they lay it up and in.
Yeah, Trayvon doesn't want to pick up that second foul. They're just exposing the mismatch there with Trayvon on him.
Martin, where they're trying to lob to Tyrone right down low, but too high. As, again, it's kind of hard to throw it too high up when someone's standing 6'8", but I guess I don't know about that because I'm only 5'6".
Yeah, I'm not sure there. I think Tyrone thought there was someone behind him maybe cutting in, and he didn't really even jump for it. If he wanted to get that ball, he very easily could have. But just, that's a bad turnover there for the Lynx.
Here comes Self now back the other way. He's going to take a three from the top of the key, and he knocks it home. Self already has two in this one, as it's now 8-3 in favor of Graceland, as Tyler made a man miss right there. Got crowd going. As Martin going to try to answer from downtown? No. Seems like the energy level, the Lynx trying to match it, just can't get the shots to fall.
Yeah, Tyler made Gonzalez fall, and then he was dying to get the ball back, so because he wanted to shoot a three. They just didn't give it to him.
Gonzalez down low, answers on the other end, so it actually went in favor of Gonzalez more so than Trayvon Tyler. Martin now with it, gets a screen from right back to Tyler. Tyler's going to drive in, made his man miss, and then lays it up and in easily after the pump fake.
That's a beautiful move there from Tyler, you know, noticing that both guys are going to fly after him, just shot fake. Sees the guys just fly by him, just easy layup, uncontested.
10-5 now the score, 15 minutes remain in half number one, as Coleman trying to drive, dishes it off to Walker Jr., but he wasn't home. Tyler with it up the floor now to Jr. Jr. now trying to drive in on Gonzalez, drives baseline, kicks it out to the corner for Montez for three, and he knocks it home. Montez Crummel answers, and I'd have to say, he's our best three-point shooter.
Yeah, it's very shocking because I did not expect that coming into this year. Usually, Junior and Winslow Martin, you know, they control the three-point line for us, but you know, Montez Crumble has been Mr. Reliable from behind the arc this season.
Coleman now with it. He thought about a three from the top of the key. Instead, gives it back to Self. Self give and go with Coleman. This time, he'll take it right on the wing. No good. Rebounded by Martin. Baseball pass down to Tyler. Tyler going to go coast to coast, and he'll just lay it up and in. Thought maybe for a second he might slam that home. 2 years ago, he does.
Yeah, I mean, he's not on the right side of the rim. He has to be on the left side of the rim because he has to jump off of 2 feet, but that's going to be an early timeout for Coach Hoff in Graceland. What a start. I mean, this has been a completely different team than what we saw the other night.
No, you're exactly right. I think it's a better start from this team that knows what they're capable of. I mean, you saw it firsthand the opposite night. They played well at some points in time. You don't want to say they were playing scared, but it was almost like they were playing to the level of competition at the level at the time of the game. Wouldn't you say?
Yeah, they're playing down to whatever the other team is doing, except Kokomo was just making absolutely everything, and we were trying to go back and hit threes of our own. It just wasn't falling for us. But, you know, with this game, I think the home crowd definitely helps. We have, like, a different like, swagger coming out of the locker room. Just, it seems like we're just so much more comfortable out there than we are on the road.
Well, we always know that this is a team that loves to show off. I think that's an understatement of putting it that way. But they love it. And like you mentioned, this time the crowd is on our side of things, maybe encouraging in it just a little bit. But you know how that always makes Trayvon Tyler's game step up, which leads to Crumble, which then leads to Junior, and then it leads to the rest of the guys on this team.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing bigger that could happen than that Trayvon crossover was a big dunk, and I'm expecting either Winslow Martin or Tyrone Wright to throw one down tonight. Maybe even Tyler if he gets a fast break going his way.
Coming out of the timeout, it will be Yellow Jackets basketball as we're tied at 10 with 14 minutes remaining in this first half. Now Tyrone Wright on Walker Jr. We'll see what they can do. He's trying to back his man down. So he kicks it to the corner here for the for three. No good, as that was Newsham that took that one. Here comes Tyler now back the other way here for the Lynx. He's going to take a step back jumper over Franklin. No. It's a good look, though, as it's pulled down by Graceland.
Yeah, not a bad look. I'd like to see a little more passing right there. Just get a few more passes before a shot. That was pretty early in the shot clock.
And this was a Lynx team that led by 21 at one point in game number one, as there's a three from the top of the key. No good by Hernandez. Saved from going out of bounds is Martin. And here come the Lynx now back the other way, looking to take the lead. Junior with it. He's going to pull up from the wing, and you already know it. Darnell Latham Jr. knocks down a three, and that's great to get him going here early in this ball game.
This kid can score. I mean, Darnell Latham Jr., probably one of the better scorers I've ever seen. Just there's a certain confidence or cockiness you get when you shoot the basketball. Him and Trayvon Tyler just shoot the basketball with such confidence.
Self trying to answer, no, but an offensive rebound, no. Put back, no, but the offensive rebound for the third time goes Hernandez's way, and he lays it up and in, 13-12, as Tyler going to try to back down Self. Turn around, spin move, still can't get that one to go. Gets his own miss, basically put it right over Self. Now it's ball's loose on the floor. Tyler ends up coming up with it. Ball's still loose, and now he'll find Junior maybe one more time. Instead, he goes to the corner for Tyrone Ryan. They're going to set up this offense.
Yeah, I like just not forcing anything. Set up the offense, get a good play right here.
Junior with it now. He's thought about driving baseline instead. I think he was attempting, was going to attempt a step back jumper, but they're going to actually call, I believe, a foul. Oh, I thought for a second that a foul was actually going to go on Junior, but instead it goes on Trey Newsham. And we're going to take a timeout right here. I believe that's a media timeout, so we'll hear a quick word from our sponsors real quick.
Grouse Chevrolet in Buick and is proud to be a sponsor this season of Lincoln College men's and women's basketball on 89X and our sister station, LCTV. Thanks to their generous support, you'll never miss a single broadcast this season as the Lynx compete in NAIA action. Grouse Chevrolet Buick has served the Lincoln and surrounding area with new and used vehicles, along with a complete service department since 1953. Grouse is open Monday through Friday between 8 and 7, and on Saturdays, 8 to 3. Grouse Chevrolet Buick in Lincoln at 1905 North Kickapoo in Lincoln.
And always one of those, if want a nice truck, a nice Chevy car, or maybe even a Buick, depending on what you like. They got all different kinds of choices over there at Grouse Chevrolet. 13-12, though, our score here, as we're still at a media timeout. Adam, we talked about it a little bit at the beginning of this ballgame. You said it was a different look for this Lynx team, and what do you see?
I think it's just a lot of guys that just want to be out there and they want to play. I think the crowd definitely has something to do with it. We're going to see Blake Maris check into the ballgame, or even going even smaller now without Winslow Martin in there. Basically, four point guards and a power forward in there right now with Tyrone Wright, man in the middle. So it just is a very good shooting team, and that's what they're going to try to do.
Lynx will inbound underneath their own basket, 20 seconds on the shot clock. Tyler now within the top of the key. Lynx lead by one, 13-12. To Crumble. Over to Maris, who almost had a wide open shot. Now Tyler with it, guarded by Walker Jr. Tyler trying to size his man up. Instead, he falls. Ball's loose on the floor. Somehow, Tyler still ends up hitting it off of Hernandez, but it's going to be a shot clock violation before the ball went out of bounds. And that'll give the ball right back to Graceland.
I'm surprised they didn't call that a kick. You know, they threw it, and Hernandez kicked the ball, and it went out of bounds. And that was before the shot clock went off. So, surprised they didn't give us, you know, maybe 1 second left or something on an inbounds pass.
Officials trying to be fair here, as one of the officials used to work here at Lincoln College. It's 13-12 now, as that one knocked down from way downtown by Franklin, and it's all of a sudden a two-point lead for Graceland. Here comes Crumble trying to go the other way, has to throw it high off the glass, can't get it to go right. Was almost going to get the offensive rebound, but instead they're going to have a foul going against Graceland, as I believe that was Jordan Oliver down low holding Tyrone Wright.
Yeah, he pushed him in the back super hard, and you can see, I mean, Tyrone doesn't go down easy, but you know, he really whipped forward on that, so he definitely got shoved in the back.
Inbound it to Maris, who thought about a step back three from the corner. Instead, finds Wright. Wright handing it off to Crumble. He sees the green light open, and he puts it up off the glass. No good as he drives into the lane. Almost knocked down one of our cameras. He looks to be hurt. They say play on, though, however, as now Walker Jr. drives in, draws contact. I think that's a good foul, though, as Montez Crumble did get up off the from the ground. Instead, shaken up just a little bit, though, I didn't quite see, but he fell hard to the floor.
Yeah, and beyond that, the gym floor is concrete right over there, so I think he got his elbow or his head, you know, hit pretty hard off the concrete. Looks like Nesbitt's going to come into the ball game after this first free throw from Walker Jr.
You think he gets crumbled right here?
Yeah, I think he got to. Just, you know, give him some time. You know, his head's probably ringing a little bit right now.
Walker
Jr. going to get right.
Walker Jr. misses the first. However, though, as Jr. comes in as their Walker Jr. comes in as their leading scorer, 25 points a contest, 10 rebounds, averaging a double-double so far, does knock down the second, as he is a 50% free throw shooter, and that's exactly what he did right there as he checks out of the ballgame, as it will be Nuka Ibe now back in.
Who was a starter in the previous, in the home opener for them, but he apparently, you know, something's going wrong. He's not their starting center any longer, as Walker Jr. kind of took that role over.
When you're averaging a double-double, I think you gotta go with the hot hand, at least for now, as Crumble with it. Stayed in the ballgame, lost a little bit of the dribble. Instead gets it back now to Junior at the top of the key. 12 seconds, he's going to drive in. Right side lane instead. Takes a step back, contested jumper, and you already know they were doing that against IU Como. Seems like the only thing they could hit was a step back, and Junior knocks it down.
Yeah, this team is really good at the mid-range, and they don't really attack it that much as they should. You know, they settle for three-pointers and then they try to get to the basket. The mid-range game is pretty much lost nowadays, but you know, this team does it very successfully for the limited amount of shots that they take from that distance.
And that foul going against Montez Crumble, his first, team's fifth. So Graceland will inbound underneath their own basket. You know they're looking for a lob. Instead, they throw it out into the backcourt there for Hernandez, who almost threw it away. Instead, he does find Person, who is also one of those starters at the beginning of the year, not starting here tonight. They get down low to Oliver. Here comes the double team working on Maris. Double team spin moves baseline. Still can't get it to go as Tyler pulls down the board. Here comes Tyler now back the other way in transition for the Lynx. He's driving in. Gets it the corner for Crumble. Crumble, the most reliable three-point shooter? No. But we have an offensive foul, I believe, going against Big Roy Nesbitt underneath the basket.
Yeah, they said he extended his arm, but it's not much contact. But I guess they're going to have to call, just make it consistent throughout the whole game.
So that'll be his first, team sixth. And the Lynx, one more foul, and that'll put Graceland in the bonus. I don't think I've seen the Lynx give up this many fouls so far in 10 minutes by far. And we pride these guys on their defense. I wouldn't be surprised if the second half is a very much different story. As a three from downtown from Graceland, nope. Offensive rebound, though, goes to Nuka Ibe, and he puts it up in, maybe through contact, and he kind of gives a little grin to the crowd.
Yeah, that's one thing I noticed when he scored in the game in Graceland, just the biggest smile on his face comes across, and he just sprints down the floor.
Tyler with a bounce pass to find Roy Nesbitt, and he gets it to go. What a find from Trayvon Tyler. 18-17, 9:45 to play in this first half. Person now with it, trying to find Oliver instead. Good defense, though, by Crumble. He can't get it to him. Now Newsham with it, trying to drive in, left side. Puts it up off the glass, no. Ball's tipped into the hands of Maris. Outlet now to Junior. Junior can beat everybody down the floor, and he will. As it almost looked like a goaltending opportunity. Coach left one of it, but let's see the replay.
Yeah, look at this feed here from Trayvon. You notice Nuka Ibe right there. Nice little bounce pass over there to Nesbitt, and then got the home bounce right there. Sneaks in.
Great find from Trayvon Tyler. Is now the foul going against Hernandez, his second, team's fifth in this first half. So Junior will go to the line after the shooting, in the act of shooting, so he'll get two.
And Coach Lepp and McGee and me as well, we wanted a goaltend right there. You know, the defender hit the rim or grabbed the net and forced the rim to shake a little bit. I mean, the shot really didn't have a chance to go in, but I mean, if you move the rim like that, it should be an automatic goaltend.
Does make the first right there, 18-18, as we're tied up again. Lynx can take the lead back by one after this next free throw, as Winslow Martin, the second, checks back in. He got Maris, and Junior, very good from the free throw line. I believe by far the best shooter, 84% from the free throw line.
Really, this team has not been that bad from the free throw line like in past years. I mean, they've been pretty reliable from the stripe this season.
Walker Jr. now with it, hands it off to Oliver, who's guarded by Trayvon Tyler, who had it poked away. Ball's loose on the floor by Roy Nesbitt. I don't think he had to dive for it. Instead, he does. Love the hustle. Then Oliver Jordan cannot, Jordan Oliver can't save it from going out of bounds. So to give the ball right back to this Lynx team after the turnover.
I mean, just the hustle right here from the Lynx. I just love how much, you know, the mindset that we're coming into this ball game with. It seems like it's a completely different team.
19-18 now the score. Tyler with it at the top of the key. Looking for Martin. Instead goes to Nesbitt. Nesbitt thought about a three. Good shot fake there from Nesbitt. I know Coach Lett preaches that. And then banks it home with the left hand. Adam, that even got you excited a little bit up here.
I did not expect that move whatsoever. I mean, I've never seen Roy move that quick. Just the spin move there was deadly.
Person takes a jumper, no good. Luka Ibe with the offensive rebound and a foul in the act of shooting, so that'll put him at the line for two opportunities as the Lynx lead 21-18. Foul is going to go on Martin, his second, team seventh, as it was a shooting foul, so he's already at the line for two opportunities, but now that puts Graceland in the bonus.
Yeah, I think really there, Nesbitt came out to guard the high post, which really opened up the lane for Nuka Ibe to get that rebound here as he knocks down the first.
And so far, though, for Nuka Ibe, 0-for-2 on free throws, so 1-of-3 now on the season. So not the greatest free throw shooter as well. As now everybody is so confused. You know Nesbitt has to stay on Walker Jr. right
there. Yeah, Nesbitt was, he just really, he wanted to be the guy boxing out Walker Jr. So wherever he was going, Roy was going as well.
I was going to say, that comes on Walker Jr. right there. The crowd getting into it just a little bit. It started with Roy Nesbitt, and now it ends up into the hands of Walker Jr., his second personal foul, team sixth. And you know he's checking out of this ballgame because here comes Hernandez and Gonzalez back into the contest.
Yeah, that's big. That's definitely a good sign for the Lynx. You want to get their best player out, I mean, off the floor at all times. And Nesbitt just doing a good job of just kind of getting in the in Walker Jr.'s head. You know, he was constantly following him, following around. I mean, you're not going to get around Nesbitt. I mean, look at the guy. I mean, he's definitely the only guy physically imposing enough to go up against him, and I think he's doing a good job so far.
I think he did a great job right there getting in his head. And it's 21-19 lead for the Lynx. Not as big as the last one that they had, but still looking to score more. Junior, now to Nesbitt. You know he's going to pop that from downtown, and he knocks it through. Big Roy Nesbitt ends up hitting a three and banks it home.
Yeah, just banks it home. I mean, I don't want to call that shot lucky because I see Roy hit that shot all the time. I mean, he's got some touch there for a big guy. The lefty stroke looks smooth no matter what.
And here comes Coleman the other way, and he lays it up with the right hand. Apparently, the State Bank of Lincoln was open on that shot.
Yeah, it definitely was there for Roy.
24-21. It's this time Junior knocks it home. Darnell Latham Jr., they're answering. All of a sudden, this Lynx team, 27-21 here in this contest with 7.5 minutes remain in the first half.
I love the crowd right there. Just getting the crowd involved. That's just a defensive breakdown right there for the Lynx. Just allowing Hernandez just to walk in the lane and get that open layup.
Tyler with a good move right there. Count the basket and the foul. Trayvon Tyler makes two-man miss and then goes to the line for an and-one opportunity.
I'm sure Trayvon's got to be happy to be home. I mean, he does this. If you guys are wondering, like, that arm-waving thing, Trayvon does that on the road. I mean, Trayvon speaks to the crowd like this on the road, so I mean, just imagine having the crowd on your side instead of booing you every time you do something like that.
Mentioned it right there. Trayvon Tyler getting this crowd fired up here in game number two. The Lady Lynx already won. This crowd was waiting. This Lynx team was waiting to come home and see a game like this. I'm glad here on Alumni Weekend that these fans came out to support not just the alumni, not just the staff, not just the faculty, but all these students here at the gym. It's other sports teams coming out supporting this team because this is desperately what they needed. Even last year, we did not see this type of crowd, and they were 22-8.
Yeah, I mean, I love the crowd. I mean, as long as there's a crowd here, I mean, this team is going to play better. And I think these students understand that, so they want to come out and support. I mean, even the JV game was just this packed, and it was, you know, just as loud and everything like that. So I love the atmosphere we're creating in the Jack D-Nutt Arena every night.
I couldn't agree with you more. And so far, it might be paying off a little bit. We've seen this Lynx team down the stretch a few times. They love that run-and-gun type mentality, but they get a little too careless sometimes. But right now, with the home court advantage, they're taking care of the basketball. They're playing within their element, and the crowd only helps that element step up to the next level.
Yeah, it adds another thing to put pressure on the opposing team. You know, if we don't have that home court atmosphere, it's just a key thing missing for us.
Tyler missed the and-one opportunity right there, but it's 29-23 lead still for the Lynx. However, with just over 7 minutes remain in this first half, Oliver trying to drive in. He'll knock a jumper down from the baseline. That was Person, as it's now back to a four-point lead for the Lynx. And this is a Lynx team that has really been more comfortable slowing the pace down a little bit.
Yeah, we had to play slow against Kokomo. We just didn't have the legs to go toe-to-toe with them in transition. So, you know, we're used to doing both. So it's just, I think whatever's working for us right now.
As Junior knocks down a three right there yet again. I mean, this is the type of game where he had 32. This is the type of shots he made.
Yeah, I mean, he hit five threes in that first half against IU East when he scored that 32. So, I mean, he's definitely on pace for that now.
Nuka Ibe goes to the rack. Still can't finish. Tip back, no. Roy Nesbitt is there, and we have a foul. Offensive foul going against Graceland. I believe that's on Nuka Ibe for over the back, and we're going back the other way.
There's that last shot from Junior. Just confident, just going to rise up into that three-pointer. He actually got fouled on that shot as well, so... I mean, just what a player. I mean, this dude can score no matter what.
As it's now Nesbitt, I mentioned that foul goes on Nuka Ibe. That's the team's eighth, his first, as that'll put Nesbitt at the line for a one-on-one opportunity, and he cannot hit as it's 32-25. Still in favor of the Lynx, though, however, 7-point lead. Graceland in the Yellow Jackets now with it. Coleman picks up his dribble. He's guarded by Junior. Trying to find Person now, gets a screen instead. Thought about driving baseline. Now back down to Coleman. Takes a mid-range jumper from the baseline, no short. Gets his own miss though, however. Turnaround, spin move, right-hand hook, no. But we have a foul away from the basketball yet again, going against Graceland underneath, an offensive foul. And let's see if we walk all the way back down the floor yet again.
It should be on Nuka Ibe once again. And it is, that's his second in a matter of a minute. That's gonna send Nesbitt to the line once again. They're saying that he is extending the arm on the rebound, which I do agree with. You know, he's getting a little too, bows are a little too out too wide there for a ref's liking.
I agree. I saw a little bit of contact down low, and it's pretty easy to see when you stand over top of everybody else.
Yeah. Him and Nuka Ibe and Nesbitt, I mean, those two just battling down the block. I mean, there's probably a foul of, like, literally every single contact just because those guys are so physically imposing that every hit is a huge hit.
Didn't affect Graceland though that much, as Nesbitt did miss the free throw, but now we have another offensive foul going against Graceland on back-to-back possessions. This time it's going on Person with a little bit of a push off himself, and the Lynx will get the basketball back.
Yeah, it was a moving screen there from Person. He handed off the ball and then just kind of backed his defender back. I mean, it's basically screening without actually setting up a screen, but the refs got him there.
Tyler thought about a step back three. Instead, he gives it up to Junior. Junior with 14 seconds now on the shot clock. Gonna have to drive in. He's double teamed. Somehow finds Martin. Martin now trying to drive in. Puts it off the glass. No, too strong. I think that contact there a little bit made him mistime his shot just a tad. As here comes Grayson now back the other way. Person with it, guarded very closely by Trayvon Tyler. You know he's going to give it his all effort here today. I'm sure this crowd is willing and waiting to see what Trayvon Tyler has in store for us. I'm kind of excited as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's his last first home game, so, I mean, he's got to put on a show.
As Oliver double-teamed, 4 seconds on the shot clock now. Person's down low to Franklin, who gets it up and in just in time before the shot clock violation.
Yeah, it's just in time. They could probably review that if we had the capability.
As Tyler fell to the floor, no foul called. Jump ball, possession arrow will go to Graceland in this contest as your Lynx lead 32-27 with 4:40 left to go in the half. Don't forget, we will be talking to Coach McGee down the stretch at halftime to see get his thoughts about Coach Lepp's first half, and then the state representative Tim Butler and his brother Mike, who also played here at Lincoln College back in the 1970s. They're here for Alumni Weekend. He will be our guest for the halftime show. 32-27 lead for the Lynx. We'll see if they can maintain it here throughout the next 4.5 minutes as Graceland has the basketball. Person trying to drive in, count the basket and the foul. Nesbitt caught him on the arm as he went up for it, as he blew right past him, and all of a sudden, Graceland kind of sneaking their way back into this ballgame.
Yeah, I mean, they really haven't been behind for that long. So as long as they just kind of just temporarily just keep the bleeding to a minimal, I mean, they're right in this ballgame, and they could possibly turn it into a one-point game.
32-29 as he knocks down the end one opportunity. Now all of a sudden it's a two-point game. 32-30 with 4.5 to play in this first half. I mentioned the Lady Lynx won in game number one, 85-72 over IU East, a team that these Lynx teams already beat once. It was an upset win, as Martin gonna take a hesitated three, and he knocks it down. He wears number three for a reason, and he just showed why.
He's one of those Mr. Reliable kind of shooters. I mean, coming out of the gates, when we first saw this team play, I did not expect him to be that good of a shooter, but he averaged 25 points per game in JUCO for a reason, and that shooting is definitely on display today.
35-30 now, as this game we knew was gonna be close down the stretch, as they made it a game in the second half, as Jordan Oliver count the basket and the foul. Montez Crummel was trying to go for the steal and the loose ball, but it found the hands of Oliver, and he tried to just go straight up with it, and Crummel wrong place, wrong time, as he sends Oliver to the line for an and one.
Yeah, just not what we want to do. Just if they get that wide open of a layup, just don't even worry about it. Just let them lay it in and just go back down on the offensive end.
35-32 now, as here comes Garrett Hooker into the contest for his first minutes as a Lynx in his career. So we'll see what Garrett Hooker can do with the headband. He actually, in Kogmo, had the ponytail, in the front ponytail. And what did Coach Lepp call him?
He called him, I think he said, if you're going to dress like a unicorn, you better play like one too, I believe was the exact quote from Coach Lepp. And I'm glad he went with the headband today. He went with the headband the other night during the JV game as well.
Very, very interesting. As he will get his first minutes, we'll see if he can play like a special unicorn here in these minutes. Tyler now with it, trying to drive baseline. Instead, finds Maris. Maris made one man miss instead. Can take a three from the top of the key, no good, but he did draw a foul, not in the act of shooting, but that'll send him to the line for two shots because that was the team's 10th.
I mean, good awareness there from Maris. And notice that dude is just flying out on him, so he's just going to take that little pump fake. That's going to get the guy flying up in the air, and he draws the foul.
Maris knocks down the first right there, as he does come in a 100% free throw shooter. Only had three attempts, though, with that make right there. So Maris' second one, very confident from the line. Knocks down a pair, and it's back to a four-point lead here for the Lynx. 37-33, 3:30 left to play in this first half. Graceland with the basketball. They trail as they get it down low to Gonzalez, trying to work in on Garrett Hooker, and he does a hook shot right over top of him.
I mean, there's not much that Garrett could have done. He was playing really good defense, went straight up on him, and just without committing a foul, that's as best as he could do.
Tyler trying to answer from downtown. No, pulled down by Graceland. Here comes Person now back the other way, along with Coleman, who drives baseline all over Tyler and somehow still finishes through contact. Now we're tied at 37 here. We'll see if the Lynx can retake the lead. Under three to play. Tyler with it. Thought about driving baseline. Instead picks it up. Finds Martin at the top of the key. Martin looking for Junior. He has the hot hand in this half. Is Martin going to drive in himself? Puts up a shot. No good, but we do have a foul in the act of shooting. Now Martin and Oliver have exchanging some words. And I believe, did he just get teed up?
Yeah, Martin got teed up right there. He didn't like the contact, and there was kind of there was more contact after the play, and then they're going to immediately call a technical foul on Winslow Martin in the second. Very quick whistle right there.
And Martin teed up from the official right there. And Lynx, we're going to get the basketball back and shoot two free throws. I'm sure they will after these technical free throws will come into play as they will put Person at the line, who, again, if you look at the numbers, hasn't shot a free throw all season.
And they put him at the line for the technical free throws, which surprising, which he hasn't shot one all year, but that's Coach Hoff has some confidence in Person.
He must have. He knew what he was doing. He knocks down a pair right there. And again, the technical foul goes on Winslow Martin, the second. So he picked up a foul, and with that, so that's now his third, team's 10th. So Martin definitely going to have to be careful down here in the next two minutes and 45 seconds.
Yeah, definitely going to have to be careful. He goes the line for two. And out of all the starters, I definitely have to say he was probably the weakest free throw shooter on the squad. He hasn't been as consistent as the other guys so far this season.
Just a 75% free throw shooter. And that is, out of all the ones that are starting, the lowest one. But he does hit one of two, however, and the Lynx only trail by one. 39-38, 2:30 left to play in this first half. Person's now with it. He gets a screen from Gonzalez, drives in, right side lane, puts up a floater, no. Rebounded by Martin. Here come the Lynx now back the other way. Thought about in transition now. Martin trying to go coast to coast. Tried to jump stop, but has it stolen away by Oliver. Outlet now to Person. Give and go with Coleman, and he can't hit. Tipped back in by Oliver. Into the hands of Maris, who couldn't hit. Now to Junior. Coming back the other way are the Lynx. Junior thought about a step back jumper. Instead, Tyler with it. Makes a pump fake. The guys could not find the ball instead. There's a foul going against Gonzalez, as Junior took a three, was no good off, but he will go to the line for three opportunities.
I mean, just Junior just being aggressive once again. I love the aggression that he's showing in this first half. He's going to go to the line for three free throws. That's also the third foul on Gonzalez, so that's going to be crucial down the stretch for Graceland. They're staying in this ball game despite having Walker on the bench for so long. Junior did make the first, make it 39-39.
It is all squared up as Junior, like we mentioned, a lights out free throw shooter for this Lynx team. Has not missed very often from the line. And actually, this is where he gets most of his points from the line. He does make all three, but if you look at Junior's stats, averages 17 points a game, but doesn't shoot the ball particularly well so far this season, but he still finds a way to with 15 to 18 points.
Yeah, you could call him a chucker. That's definitely a good name for him. He likes to shoot the basketball. I'll give him that. He's very confident in his jump shot, and he should be. It's a very, very nice looking jump shot.
Tyler tips that one away. Somehow into the hands of Oliver, though, however. And we have a traveling violation right there on Graceland, as it looked like Maris was about seconds away from picking up his first foul. Instead, they call the travel as he checks out. Good minutes by him for Tyrone Wright. 41-39 lead for the Lynx here late in this first half. Minute 45 to go as Trayvon Tyler, Roy Nesbitt Jr., Wright, and Crummel all out on the floor for the Lynx. Rocking the new home white uniforms. Tyler give and go with Nesbitt, and he'll lay it up and in. Good touch by the big fella.
Yeah, just another great pass there from Tyler, just feeding the big guy down low. I love the touch there from Nesbitt.
43-39 now, over to Coleman, back to Coleman. He drives baseline, kicks it to the corner in Franklin. Franklin sets his feet and knocks down a long three from the left side corner to put us back up by one.
They're staying in this ball game despite their best player being on the bench. I just got to give it up to Coach Hoff. He got a great game plan going against us, and they're just staying in this game as much as they can.
Tyler finds Nesbitt from downtown, trying a little bit of the magic one more time. Instead, he could not. Here comes Graceland now back the other way. Oliver trying to drive in. No, but we have a putback basket by Nuka Ibe. We'll see what they want to call right here.
And going back to that Tyler feed, just wide open there for Nesbitt, just down the lane, just right down Main Street for the easy lay-in.
43-42. They actually put that foul on Nesbitt, so that'll be his third as well. So now Martin and Nesbitt both in foul trouble with three fouls apiece. as that puts Oliver at the line. 50% free throw shooter.
Well, there's a stoppage of play here. There's a malfunction going on with the scoreboard because I didn't think Roy has fouled before then. Same with Winslow Martin. They said that was his third foul, but yeah, they went up and checked it. They said it's right.
We saw the other day at Kokomo, they put that one on Montez Crumble. He was nowhere even in the...
Yeah, nowhere in the vicinity.
So he does knock down the first right there. Oliver does. And we're tied at 43. Second free throw coming. He knocks down a pair. And Graceland retakes the lead. 44-43. We're under a minute to play. Lynx have the basketball here in this first half. Trail by one. As we knew this game was going to be close throughout, we'll see what happens here. Tyler drives in, dishes it off to Nesbitt. Down low with the left hand, and you already know. Nesbitt having himself a little bit of a game here early in this first half.
It goes back to just another great feed there from Tyler. Just he's getting Nesbitt involved, and that's really good for Nesbitt's confidence going forward.
And shot clock and game clock separated by about a second and a half. So this could be the final possession as Oliver with it, double teamed, give and go with, I believe that was Franklin out to Self, who takes a three. No. Offensive rebound now poked away by Wright. As there's 3 seconds to go, they give it down low to Franklin yet again. He can't hit. Ball still loose. Nuka Ibe with it, puts it back up and in, but they will say no shot. As it's 45-44 here at halftime. The Lynx leading the way just by one. This has been a great first half. Already some chirping going on. Don't go anywhere. 45-44 here at halftime. Your Lynx on top of Graceland University Yellow Jackets. And we will be right back with the halftime show with Tim Butler and the president, Dr. David Gerlach, along with here from Coach McGee. Don't go anywhere. You're listening or watching, excuse me, on LCTV Basketball.
See on page 4 that the projections need to be blood. Next Thursday?
Seriously? Thursday? Can't do that.
This is really inconvenient.
I have yoga that day.
I have no time for this. So,
I can't do Thursday, but I can do Friday.
Disasters? Don't plan ahead. You can. Talk to your loved ones about how you're going to be ready in an emergency. Don't wait. Communicate.
Since I was young, my friends told me, and my coaches, that I'd be a good coach someday. It was my senior year and it was crunch time. And Lincoln College with a sports management degree, and it just, like, something clicked.
I've just always had a passion for sports. There's a lot of opportunities out there within sports management.
It's for anybody that has a love of sport in general, and also from the standpoint of administration. But more importantly, just the love of the game and also the opportunity to work with others. The opportunities that they get at Lincoln College, they won't find as many other places from the, you know, having the opportunity to get hands-on experience, you know, throughout the college itself as we transition to four-year athletics and in our community.
I coached a summer travel baseball team for 3 years, which I'm now the president of. So the goal is to be an athletic director. They organize schedules, they work with coaches. There's an athletic director at all levels, junior high, recreational programs, high school, college.
The types of jobs available to our students when they graduate here cover the whole sport arena from youth sports all the way up to professional sports. And there's a lot of different disciplines that you could find yourself working in also.
I've helped with college, higher education, I've helped with high school and junior high, and all those experiences helped me get the positions that I'm able to get now, even before graduating college.
Day after day, I learned something that I could use when we're in a board meeting or for a parent meeting or our flyers for tryouts, stuff like that. Just all the classes that I've had, I never felt like I didn't learn something that would help out with where I'm at now as the president or being the head coach of other schools and things.
All right, we're finally back here in the Jack D. Nutt Arena. I have Coach Ed McGee with me It was a good first half. You guys lead by one. But what are some takeaways that you guys can improve on in the second half?
I believe we got to really box out and rebound. We're getting too many second chance points. We got to check out, hit bodies, and get to the glass. Also, offensively, we got to continue to attack in space. I think the ball is sticking too much. We got to continue to let the ball flow, let it sing, and get open looks.
And we've been on the road constantly. Our first home opener here in this one. How does the crowd fare when they're on our side this time?
It's great, man. It's a great feeling to be back home, to be able to play in front of our home crowd and get that energy. So hopefully we continue to feed off the energy and come out with a win.
And thank you so much, McGee. Again, 45-44 here at halftime. Don't go anywhere, though. We will have Tim Butler, the representative, the state representative here for Illinois as well. Again, he'll be our halftime show. Don't go anywhere. More action on LCTV.
If you love them enough to suck the snot out of their nose at 4 a.m., then surely you'll check nhtsa.gov/the right seat to make sure they're in the right car seat.
Meet the Scan, a simple procedure whose mission is to detect lung cancer early.
I'm here to save you.
But I feel fine.
That's great, but you may still be at high risk for lung cancer.
Oh man, that's a new fence.
If you smoke, early detection could save your life. Learn more at savedbythescan.org.
150 over 90.
180 over 111.
160 over 110. I had a stroke.
This is what high blood pressure looks like. You might not feel its symptoms, but the results from a stroke are far from invisible or silent. If you've come off your treatment plan, get back on it, or talk with your doctor to create an exercise, diet, and medication plan that works for you. Go to loweryourhbp.org.
If I would have followed a treatment plan, I would not be in this situation.
If you love them enough to suck the snot out of their nose at 4 a.m., then surely you'll check nhtsa.gov/the right seat to make sure they're in the right car seat.
I don't remember how it started.
Start to that.
Oh boy.
Our back and forth. It always came back. You probably don't remember what you told me.
That was perfect.
But I heard every word.
Talk to Gerlach.
Welcome back inside the Jack D. Nutt Arena here on Alumni Weekend, and I got alumni at least right now with me here in this one. Again, Mike Butler and State Representative Tim Butler as well here in a great, great looking interview. Again, we'll start with Tim. Again, talk to me a little bit. You talked about you represent four different counties.
Yep, so I live in Springfield, represent four counties, smack dab in the middle of the state, and Lincoln and Logan counties in my area, so I'm here all the time. President Gerlach does a great job reaching out to me, and my brother's a grad, so I'm proud to represent the Lynx in the General Assembly, that's for sure.
Now, real quick here, you saw this first half. This is a Lynx team that is on the rise, moving conferences now into the NAIA. What have you seen out of this Lynx team so far?
Well, Royale coming off the bench there was a real spark for him in the first half, and he's a big guy, man. He was throwing it around. He had a good first half, and hopefully we'll see, you know, up by one, we'll see the same thing that the women did earlier, that they turn it on in the second half and have a good victory here for the Lynx.
And he mentioned that he was a North Ender. I'm also a North Ender. In heart, I guess I should say, I went to Lanphier Northside Pride, as they would love to call that one. Again, Mike, you played here at Lincoln College. Talk to me a little bit, I believe back in the 1970s?
76.
Talk to me a little bit about that. We were still a JUCO at the time, so
right.
Tell me how that is a little different now between going NAI from JUCO.
Mainly we were tall, slow down, not as quick. A little bit taller guys. We did have good teams. We traveled a lot. Went to Hutchinson, Kansas a couple times. Big tournaments down in St. Louis. But we had some good teams back there too. Not as quick as these guys, okay? But it wasn't deliberate, but it was. There were some good teams back then too.
Oh, I'm sure. Talk to me a little bit though. What was one of your favorite moments at the college as well?
You know, I've always felt strongly about small community. At that time, Lincoln College obviously was a junior college, smaller school than what it is now, but it was very connected to the community, to the student body. It was really close knit, and that's what I really liked about coming down here. If it was a four year school, I would have stayed, but I didn't. I went on to Eureka College, graduated from there, but I had a good time here too. Played a lot of basketball, so that was good.
Oh, I can't. I'm sure about it. Again, thank you so much for coming back on Alumni Weekend. We always love to have alumni. Let's actually go back to Tim here real quick. You can hand it right over. I know it's right in front of me. You guys are trees compared to me. I wish I had the height to play basketball. But
the thing he didn't mention was he also met his wife here at Lincoln College, his wife Kathleen.
Okay.
So they're both Lincoln College graduates, yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
I also understand why you didn't either. So I do feel you on that one. Again, though, Tim, talk to me a little bit. Just tell the viewers back at home, as a state representative, just talk to them a little bit about what you do.
So I'm their voice in Springfield. I get to vote on legislation in Springfield. I get to introduce legislation, and I get to advocate for our communities. So it's an honor for me to represent Logan County and Lincoln. We try to do good things in the General Assembly. Like I said earlier, President Gerlach and I talk all the time. If there's issues that come up before the General Assembly, I'll call them. I'm here on campus. I'm here in a couple weeks. We're touring Creekside and doing that stuff. So it's a good opportunity for me to represent the people and hopefully give back to the communities that I represent.
And now, what's your thoughts here on going 4 years now? Because it seems like you're going to be here a lot more.
I think it's great. I think what they're doing with the new conference is going to be going into with adding some sports and things like that. I think it's a great thing for the university. I think it's a great thing for the community. And I think you're going to see Lincoln College continue to grow and be a great place of education here in Central Illinois.
And thank you so much, guys. Tim Butler and his brother Mike Butler. He's the alumni here in this one. And again, also met his beautiful wife as well at Lincoln College. So a lot of us making great memories here, and it can't do it out without the president, Dr. David Gerlach. Again, making fond memories here at Lincoln College. I'm glad it's 4 years. I get to stay in, and actually for my fifth year here in this one.
It so much you're staying 5 years.
I did. I loved it so much that I stayed 5 years. Don't tell my mom. Maybe some grades had to do with that as well. But however, though, thank you so much, guys, for joining us up here in this one.
Thanks, Nick.
As we're going to get back to the game. But again, stay tuned. A lot of great basketball coming your way. 45-44 here at halftime.
Look at you. You're at the top of your game. You're unstoppable. Nothing can throw you off track. Wait, is that your car? Uh-oh. Yeah, I saw that coming. That will throw you off track. You're looking at around 10 grand in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Let's try this again. Smart move. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
I love coming in to work every day, because what I'm seeing from students every day is the exact same passion that I had as an undergraduate exercise science major student. So I, you know, that's like one of the driving factors for me every day. So exercise science is one of the fastest growing major in this country. One of the reasons is probably because of the multifaceted nature of this major, which allows students to take their love of sports and exercise to the next level.
Playing at the college level gives you that fire. You feel like you're a pro, and going into like something like exercise science makes you like more passionate about it. Like, that's what you want to do.
From the sidelines, when I would be rehabbing myself, I would fire my athletic training experience to my teammates. And so then just from there, I never really put a name to it, but I've always been kind of rehabbing everyone, so that's kind of what sparked my attention.
Students can take a route to be an athletic trainer, you can be an exercise physiologist, or you can choose a sports psychology route, just like I did, and also maybe a physical education teacher.
I was majoring at exercise science in a different university, a larger university, and I decided to transfer back.
Yeah, I definitely like the small school atmosphere. Looking at other bigger schools that had the exercise science program, I didn't know how it fit in or how it would do in the classrooms with like 100 other kids, or it's not the fit for me.
I wanted to work in a small institution where I can interact with students, because that was my experience as an undergrad. I went to a small college. Even in big schools, like, schools won't pay for it. The reason I chose Lincoln College is this institution was dedicated to this program, and there it had a budget to initiate this performance lab.
I felt I could receive the same experience but more focus compared to a large university. It wouldn't be competing for attention or opportunities.
I truly want all the students to, to take the opportunity. Don't miss this.
Set up. Welcome back inside the Jack D. Nutt Arena here, getting ready to start the second half. And Adam, it's a one-point game. I'm sure that it's going to be a good one. 45-44 lead here for the Lynx going into the second half. Much different story than in game number one, where they had a comfortable 20-point lead. But what do you see on the stat sheet that kind of pops out to you, and maybe the Lynx are doing either a good job at it or could improve on?
Well, the good thing is, I mean, we only have six turnovers. That's the good thing, but we're getting absolutely demolished on the glass. Graceland has 26 total rebounds with 11 offensive rebounds. We have 12 rebounds total with zero offensive rebounds, so just getting killed on the glass, we need to do a better job. We're not going that big of a lineup, so that's probably why.
As the Lynx will get the basketball to start the second half, and they're going to let that run all the way down the floor, as that was going to be a backcourt violation right there. Tyler's pass to Wright off the hands. And that's how this second half is going to start. And we know that this is a Lynx team, not a very solid second half team, but we've seen it in years past. They play well at times down the stretch.
I think that's going to change once we get a home court. I think that's going to change. We're going to get probably be a better home court team. So that is likely to change here today.
And same starting five out there for both squads, as Graceland will have their first attempt, but we have a foul away from the basketball. This go around, maybe not, actually.
I think it was a shot clock.
It was a shot clock?
Yeah, it was a shot clock. They didn't know if it had started or not. I believe it was right. It said it was 18 seconds left. It seems like they had the ball for that long.
Be about.
They're going to keep it at 18.
As they inbound it to down low on Walker, trying to find Tyler, but he steals it away, finds Crumble. Crumble going coast to coast, cannot get that one to go, and it's rebounded by Graceland, and then a foul 90 feet away from the basket going against Montez Crumble.
It's not the smartest foul there for Crumble. That's going to be his third foul, so definitely not, since it's his third, but just you want to see him just try to get that little fight there after missing that layup.
Now three Lynx players with three or more, or at least three fouls, him, Nesbitt, and Martin, who's also out there on the floor. So two out of the three playing right now is Walker Jr. double team. They're trying to find Gonzalez down low, 13 seconds on the shot clock. Instead, they go to Franklin. Franklin back to Walker Jr., and they're going to have an offensive foul right there. Tyler stood his ground, and Walker Jr. just threw his elbow right into him, and that's an offensive foul every single time.
Yeah, it was a hook call, as they say it, when he went for the post spin. He really wrapped around Tyler's back. So that's going to be, yeah, like you said, just a foul every single time there on the offensive side.
45-44. Still nobody has scored in this second half. About a minute played so far here in this one, as Latham Jr. now with it. He's driving in left side lane, puts one up off the glass. Good move, though. Just couldn't get it to finish through the rack, but I like the effort there by number 12, Darnell Latham Jr.
Yeah, just he likes to get to the basket, and he likes to get to that free throw line. So if the foul's not there, he got to finish.
Self now with it. He hands it off to Gonzalez. Out to Coleman. Kicks it back out for Franklin. Franklin from downtown, no. Offensive rebound, though, goes to Gonzalez. Put back, yes. So Gonzalez with an offensive rebound and put back, and Graceland retakes the lead by one.
Offensive rebounds, they're gonna start to add up here for Graceland. It's going to be in their favor. Junior, nice little fake there. Pull-up jumper, good.
Junior knocks down the mid-range right there, and the Lynx retake the lead right back. And I like what you said right there. Makes the man miss because they all know that he's capable of knocking down that shot.
That's the smart play definitely there by Junior. Just get him off the ground. That just creates so much chaos on the defensive side of things. And he's a nice little mid-range jumper.
Gonzalez missed but gets his own miss as it was off the hands of Tyrone Wright. I don't think he was expecting it right there. It's still 47-46. They feed Gonzalez down low. He gets double teamed. They're looking back. Out for Hernandez from the top of the key. No. Wright pulls down a huge board and finds Crumble. Lynx now back the other way. They lead by one. We'll see what they can do here. Hopefully they can add to it. Junior going to pull up from the wing, and you know it. Darnell Latham Jr. knocks down the three, and it's all of a sudden it's a four-point lead.
He had 16 in that first half. That puts him over 20 points now with that 5 points just in the second half. So what a game it's been so far for Junior.
50-46. Now, I haven't even got a chance to look at the stat sheet, but as Graceland tries to answer, he pulls down a board right there. As the ball's loose into the hands of Hernandez. Now, Self, because he lost control of it, and he'll make the knockdown jumper. But I was going to say, though, before that was being said, I would imagine Junior leading the way was at 16.
Yeah, he was at 16, and right behind him was Roy Nesbitt with 11.
There's a foul going against Graceland here in that one. We'll actually have some stats. We had all these interviews to do. That's why we didn't get a chance to talk to Mr. Hoffman about the stats. But while we have a break in the action, what else did you see from that stat sheet?
Leading the way for Graceland was Justin Person with 10 points. That just not a lot. They were really controlling the rebounding side of things. And they had 13 total fouls. So a lot of their guys kind of in foul trouble here early.
Martin going to take a three from the top of the key. Already knew it was off. As Franklin pulls down the board, a baseball pass now to Hernandez as Junior comes back quickly. And no foul was called. Wright pulls down the board. Hernandez wanted a foul, didn't get one. So did Huff, but he did not get it either. Is now Wright on the other end. We have a foul, barely a push on the other end as it goes against Graceland. And now it looks like Corey Huff wants to talk things over because he did not like the officiating on those last couple possessions by Graceland. So we're going to take a quick break as well. We'll have a live read from our sponsors.
ME Realty in Lincoln brings home buyers and sellers together in Logan County and the surrounding area. ME Realty is now at a new location at 602 Keokuk in Lincoln. You can also reach them at 217-735-5424. That's 217-735-5424. You can also reach them directly online at SethSellsLincoln.com. That's SethSellsLincoln.com. You can also see all of their latest home listings at any time. ME Realty in Lincoln is proud to be involved in the Lincoln College community and is a proud supporter of Lincoln College men's and women's basketball.
And you got to love it right there. And that one, while you were actually reading that, Adam, you could see Corey Hoff was not happy and not pleased at all by the officiating here in this one. I believe he called the timeout just to talk to them because he wasn't even in the huddle.
Yeah, sometimes they do that. Like, just he's just being a little too antsy out there, just – it's not that big of a deal. There's not that many fouls not going his way. There's another foul right there. But all the fouls they're calling against Graceland are actually fouls. I think the only one he really missed was the layup down low over here against Junior. I mean, that could be the only reason that a foul may have not have gone their way.
I think he was just you're exactly right. The only one he missed was the one right here on Junior. But it was the same foul. I think that's what frustrated him. Junior kind of gave him a little bit of push. They didn't call it. And then Wright gets pushed from behind down low, and they call it, and I believe Junior kind of gave him a little bit more oomph on the push than Walker Jr. did, but it will be batted out of bounds. It'll stay with the Lynx right here with 7 seconds on the shot clock. They lead by two, 50-48 with 16 and a half minutes remain.
Yeah, just like you said, same exact play, just different outcome. What the home team comes out with the better outcome. That's probably what the only thing he was a little upset about.
Well, it's home court advantage. We've seen it go against us so many times. As Tyler from downtown, as the shot clock expired, no. Rebounded by Graceland and Gonzalez. Here come the Yellow Jackets back the opposite direction. Self thought about pulling up from downtown. Instead finds Oliver. He'll take the chance, and he banks it home. And apparently the State Bank of Lincoln is open for everybody in Graceland, Iowa as well.
Yeah, that's basically the same exact shot that Nesbitt took earlier. That's a wide, wide right shot there by Latham Jr. Not the best shot. I'd like to see him take a little time on that.
As Oliver loses it out of bounds, it'll go back to the Lynx, who you can see the Yellow Jackets starting to get fired up there a little bit after that made basket, kind of with a little bit of help from the backboard, but it's 51-50 now. Let's see if the Lynx can respond.
Yeah, they just need a big play here. Maybe get Tyler involved going down low or just try to get Junior going to the basket.
Right with it now to Tyler. Tyler looking for Martin down low, but he stepped out of bounds on the baseline. Actually, they're going to call a foul going against Graceland with an elbow.
That's he was out of bounds for a reason, so they're saying that he was pushed out of bounds because the pass was going directly to Winslow Martin, and he was apparently all of a sudden just right out of bounds.
They throw it into Junior. Junior kicks it to the corner there for Martin. A great find. Can he hit it? And no, in and out. Ball's tipped in the air. Last touched by the Lynx as it looks like Crumble and Tyler both flying in there to try to get the offensive rebound. So it will be Graceland basketball. They also lead the way just by one. Adam, I would also say in these next 15 minutes, this game's not going anywhere. It's going to be this close.
No, I think it's going to, yeah, like I said, it's going to go down to the wire. This is a completely different team that Graceland is playing here. You know, without the depth that we had the first time we played them, you know, Porter's not here. And just, that's just, it's a big loss for us because that's Gonzalez right there with the turnaround jumper. Good little post move for the big man.
Tyler now bringing it back up the floor. They lead by three, and he hasn't stolen away. Here comes Self now back the opposite direction. It was a one-on-four fast break. So he'll slow down the pace here just a little bit, 53-50. As I was trying to look up the score of the Alabama game because it's got to be about over, but I get no service in here. So we'll have to do that another time as Oliver drives in and draws contact. He'll go to the line for two opportunities.
They're going to go. That's going to be a foul on the ground. That's going to go against Tyrone Wright. That's going to be his third. So a little caution here for Coach Leff. I'd like to see maybe Tyrone kind of sit a few minutes here, maybe get Nesbitt back in the ballgame.
Nesbitt had a very solid first half,
11 points. Like I said, also, I mean, only one rebound there for Nesbitt. But, I mean, he was just getting a lot of fouls going his way, and that's going to be the fourth foul here on Winslow Martin. So you got to get someone else in this ball game. I mean, you still got pretty much.
Well, you get your call right here.
Yeah, we're going to see.
And they did actually hand the ball to Graceland off the inbound, so Nesbitt's going to have to go back to the score table. That's why they called it off. That's a good call right there. But Martin's going to have to play with four fouls here in the next 30 seconds.
Yeah, hopefully they don't just try to expose him. If you're smart, that's what you try to do. But I think Martin is just smart enough like that. Just go straight up.
Ball's loose on the floor. Oliver gets it to the cutting Coleman, who lays it up and in. And it was a good defense, though, by Martin. He did not foul. Just the Lynx were already on the fast break opportunity, and they couldn't corral the rebound.
Yeah, he was doing the best he could on the defense without drawing the foul. Tyler, that's a strong take right there.
Tyler,
from the point guard,
lays it up and in right there. Keeps it back to a three-point game, 55-52 now. And it's going to be like this, I think, the rest of the way. We'll see. You know, I'm surprised Coach Lepp has not called a timeout yet to get Martin out of the game. We've seen that a time or two before. Not willing to use one right here. Self hits the three and then gets taken out from underneath by Crumble. And he will go to the line for a four-point play. We've seen that happen twice this year, both against us.
Yeah, just not a smart play there. It looked like Crumble was really kind of pushed into the contact right there. But either way, that's going to be four on Crumble as well. So he's got to be careful now.
And big shot there from Self. And Crumble, like you mentioned, with the four fouls, I think more fell into his legs than he did actually try to take him out. But it was an even better shot from Self. He maintained it. And all of a sudden, he got a four-point play. And that fires up Graceland. And all of a sudden, they got their biggest lead of the game as well. 59-52 as Tyler almost loses that one. Gets it right back, though. Had Wright down low. Instead, finds the cutting Junior for the reverse layup. And they'll lay it up and in. They're going to keep giving it to you. Might as well go for it.
Yeah, I think that's definitely the person we need to look forward to and just give the ball to Junior, just kind of get out of the way, just see what he can do.
As Hernandez to Self, who just made the four-point play, sets his feet. He knocks down the three-point shot. Yet again, he's got the green light. And he gave a little bit of an arrow there. That's kind of what our Lynx do after a made three. We'll see if that sparks a little bit of controversy in this ballgame, along with the Lynx, maybe get their energy back up. They're kind of been taken out of the game, along with this crowd. 62-54, Tyler going to drive in left side lane. Kicks it back out to Crumble. One more pass to Junior, who thought about a three instead. Good close out there from Graceland. Now back to Crumble. Crumble now going to drive in. Right side lane puts up a little bit of a floater. No, too strong. Oliver tipped back. No, into the hands of Self for Graceland. And he almost has it stolen away, and the ball's loose out of bounds. They're going to stay off of Self, and it's going back towards the Lynx, and they needed that desperately.
Yeah, now you can see Gerlach up there just trying to get the crowd back into this ballgame. There hasn't been much to cheer about here in this second half for the Lynx, but if the crowd gets back involved, that's really going to inspire this Lynx team to just, you know, keep doing what they're doing out there, just try to stop the bleeding temporarily.
The Lynx will get the basketball right here. Coming off of that turnover by Graceland. 62-54 lead for Graceland. See if the Lynx can respond. They were down almost at 25 at one point at Kokomo and came back and got it to within 9, I believe 7 at one point, as Tyler going to take a jumper from the free throw line. No, Nesbitt had the offensive rebound. Instead, Nuka Ibe pulls it away from him, and all of a sudden, Graceland has the basketball back with the lead. Self now with it. They're going to push everybody back towards the baseline. Nope. I guess they misran the play there a little bit. They're going to set it up and do it all over again. Coleman now with it. Guarded by Self. Here's that 3-2 zone by the Lynx, but it's not going to matter, as it looked like Franklin knocked down the three. 65-54. Still no timeout taken here by Coach Lepp. A little interested?
Yeah, I'm surprised he hasn't burned one yet. He's still got plenty. Just get them a little off the groove. They're just not missing from the three-point line right now.
He still has all six timeouts in this ball game. 65-54 as Tyler takes a step back three. No. Rebounded by Graceland. One and done yet again here by the Lynx. They're going to need another defensive stop. I'm still surprised as well Coach Lepp has not taken a timeout in this ball game. He loves to take them. He loves to use them. Surprised he hasn't yet. His Self takes a jumper right there. Almost got that one to go. Instead, back iron. And it's into the hands of Montez Crumble. Here they come now back the other way. Lynx desperately need a basket. Crumble to Tyler on the wing. Looking for Nesbitt down low. Instead goes to Junior. Junior going to try to drive in. Kick it back out. Here it's for Wright. Wright met his match with Walker Junior. Now Nesbitt will have it. 10 seconds on the shot clock. He's trying to back down his man. Puts one up off the glass. No good. Ball's tipped. Somehow into the hands of Tyrone right underneath the basket. He'll put it up and in. And there's the timeout we were so looking for by Coach Lepp. A 30-second timeout, 65-56. And I must say, it's about time.
Yeah, I think that's – yeah, he was just waiting for that basket all along. You know, just get it in our favor just before taking the timeout. You know, he wants us coming out of the timeout feeling confident instead of down. So I like the timeout right here. Here's that last play from Tyrone Wright. Just never giving up on the play and just goes right up with it. Nice play there from Tyrone Wright.
And now if you're Corey Hoff, what are you telling your guys right here in this huddle? Because you had all the momentum, but you know Coach Lepp's saying, hey, we got to get this crowd back into it. So what's he saying to his guys for Graceland?
It's going to be simple. Just keep shooting. I mean, it's going in. So just, you know, keep doing what you're doing right now. They're going to go into a 2-3 zone, so the three-point line is definitely open for Graceland.
65-56. Graceland has the basketball coming out of the timeout. We're under 11 minutes to play here in game number two. We'll see if the Lynx have a little bit of run in store for them. Saw it a few times in Kokomo, but just was never enough to get over the hump. They're going to have to do it here today to avoid their third straight loss. As they get it down low to Nuka Ibe, count the basket and the foul. Didn't look like much, but Nesbitt drew a little bit of contact, and I believe that's his fourth, and Nuka Ibe going to go to the line for an and-one opportunity.
Yeah, that's going to be Nesbitt's fourth, so, I mean, you got to get him out of the game as well. I think, I mean, Blake Maris still on the bench. Garrett Hooker still on the bench. I mean, you still got guys that we can bring in. I mean, Crumble, I'm okay with staying out on the floor. I think he's he's disciplined enough where he's not going to pick up that fifth foul. But, I mean, with Roy, if he gets beat down low, he's going to result into hacking. So that's a ballsy move here by Coach Lepp by keeping him out on the floor.
Junior now with it. 67-56. The Lynx going to need a three. Preferably just a made shot at this point as that one's poked away. Tyler trying to keep it alive. He does. Ball's loose. He puts up a little bit of a floater. I think he was going to try to go to crumble in the corner. Instead, took it himself and knocks it home.
Yeah, just caught up in the air and just decides, oh, I'm already up here, so I might as well just shoot it. And he does it. And it works.
67-58, under 10 minutes to play. We saw one Lynx win earlier. See if we can see another. Person takes a jumper. No. Fouled by, bring down by Roy Nesbitt. I actually heard the slap off of Nesbitt's arm from up here. They didn't actually call it. Nesbitt just kind of gave Franklin a look, was like, hey, man, I don't think that's the monster you want to be poking in here in this one. As Tyler back to right. I tried to feed Nesbitt down low. Instead, Tyler's going to take a three from the top of the key. No, too strong. Into the hands of Walker Jr., who's having a quiet second half.
Yeah, hasn't really played that much. He was on the bench for those two fouls, and they've just been very careful with him. I believe he actually has three. So, I mean, they're just going to play him very cautiously here in the remaining minutes.
And you do have to remember, this is a Graceland team that in 2017-2018 decided that they were basically going to win it all in the NAIA Division I. They went 29-10 in that contest as that one's stolen away by Trayvon Tyler, but it's going to be a fast break opportunity as Tyler will just lay it up and in with the left hand. Here come the Lynx, 67-60, under 9 minutes to play now.
I mean, we got to get the crowd back into us. We see Gerlach up there. Now everyone's starting to clap. This is the defensive stop that we need right here. Force one right here. Crowd's back into it.
You mentioned the crowd trying to ease their way back into it, apparently. They made a little bit of noise right there. Persons with it draws contact on the up and under move, and he will go to the line for two.
There's that last Trayvon Tyler layup. There's a little bit of contact there, but just not on the shot. If they do call a foul there, it's going to be on the ground.
And that'll send Person to the line for two opportunities. We talked about it in previous games. Coach Lepp wants his team to manage the last 8 to 10 minutes of that ball game, of this ball game, in any ball game. We'll see if he can do it right here in this one as he knocks down the first, puts it back to an 8-point lead. Winslow Martin, the second, goes to the scorer's table, willing to check back in. Coach Lepp not going to sit him long as he comes in for Roy Nesbitt, who they both have four fouls, so trading four for four, as here comes Gonzalez back into the contest as Nesbitt checks out, as he'll get Nuka Ibe.
Yeah, he knows he's going to put both of his post players into the ballgame because he knows that Winslow Martin's going to be guarding one of them, so they're just going to kind of feed him in there, and they're going to try to foul Winslow Martin out of this ballgame.
69-60, Crumble now with it, driving in. Had Junior open in the corner for three, instead takes it himself. Draws contact, and he will go to the line for two shots. As that foul looked to be on Franklin, his second, team sixth. Both teams at 16 fouls, so this is where the Lynx are going to make their money from the free throw line.
They got to knock him down late in this ball game if they're going to keep reaching in on him. So, I mean, Montez Crumble, it's a good way to start. He's a pretty good free throw shooter. Has jinxed him right there. That one rattles in and out. But just as long as we get one of them, I'll be happy.
Now you know how I feel when this happens.
Yeah, just... it's like they can hear us or something. It's just like, you know, they're going to decide to miss it just because we're talking about it.
They always make the second one, though,
yeah.
Right there. 69-61 lead for Graceland over your Lynx here on Alumni Weekend. We saw the Hall of Fame inductees. Dave Clem was the one announced as a new Hall of Fame member. He was a former wrestling coach here and also the AD at one point as Gonzalez puts it through right there, and it's back to a 10-point lead for Graceland. Lynx trying to answer though. Martin now with it. Thought about a three, instead finds Wright. Wright, I'm surprised he hasn't taken a three yet so far in this game. Crumble now to the corner for Junior. Junior with 15 seconds on the shot clock. He's going to drive baseline, instead backs it out. Across the court pass to Tyler. No look to Martin. Martin from the corner for three, and you know it. Good find and good shot there from Martin, who wears number three, and all of a sudden, again, we're getting closer and closer back to a 7-point game.
Coach Lepp's going to burn a timeout right there. I like the play here. You know, just as a good play ran by us, we got to go set something up on the defensive end. I think you got to go zone here just to protect the guys just a little bit. I know it makes the three-point line a little more vulnerable, but you know, just having the guys clogging the lane. That'll allow them to not be as focused on the three-point line. As they're going to try to get it in the lane with the zone.
No, I like what you, I like your thought process there, Mr. Hoffman. You go 2-3. I know we've also worked on a 3-2 as well.
Yeah, and we've also worked on the 1-3-1. I don't think the 1-3-1 is quite ready yet. That would be kind of like the perfect defense to run right here if, you know, the only vulnerability from the three-point line, the 1-3-1, is the corner. So, and they haven't really shot that many corner threes today. They've been more around the top of the key. So I think the 2-3 zone is probably going to be the one that Coach Love goes to, because I just think with all the foul trouble right now, it's just too dangerous to go, man.
And see President Gerlach right there as well, along with the nice crew on the scores table right there. Grunder, Mr. Grunder as well, teacher here at Lincoln College, along with Jane Bowers, who's a member of that Hall of Fame committee as well. Also the math teacher here, another great, phenomenal teachers. Two of them sitting down there. I actually had both of them, and I believe that's Jacob Harnagy down there doing the stats as well.
Yeah, so just for Graceland, we're going to apply a little bit of a press here, which is, it's kind of dangerous. I don't think Kremble should be manning the point here on this press. I think Tyler is the one to do it, and they're going to go man-to-man, and Tyler's going to guard Walker Jr.
And we'll go with Greg Kendall down there on that one. I don't think they're laughing at it as well. Maybe they could hear me from down there or not. That one's stolen away into the hands of Trayvon Tyler, but it was Greg Kendall at the scorer's table. As Darnell Latham Jr. from downtown, no. Long rebound into the hands of Walker Jr. for Graceland. Here they come now, back the other way. Coleman with it, drives baseline, up and under move, gets to go. That's not what the Lynx needed in there, and this one is, it's now 73-64.
He's got to get something here. I'd like to see a three-pointer here or just a bucket down low. Maybe try to get it to Tyrone Wright. Loose ball on the floor. It's going to be a jump ball. And it's going to be, that's going to be Graceland's ball.
Crumble was down there in the middle of the action, but it will give the ball right back to Graceland. Under 7 minutes to play, 73-64. It's a nine-point lead for Graceland. I read it the wrong way, as Graceland will have the basketball. Coming off of that jump ball. And the Lynx desperately need to stop yet again. It seems like every time they try to get the crowd back into it, Graceland does something impressive enough to kind of quiet the crowd back down. We'll see if the Lynx have an answer. 73-64 as Person. Now to Walker Jr., who thought about driving in, back to Person. Instead takes one man, takes a pump fake and then makes a man miss, but gets his own miss off the rebound, as it was kicked out, and that one into the hands of Martin, and the Lynx get a desperate stop that they most desperately needed right there. Martin to the corner, and Junior over to Tyler. Back to right at the top of the key. Both of them had good looks. Instead, Martin, he'll take it from downtown. No good. I believe that three should have came from Junior down the stretch. He had a good look, didn't take it.
Yeah, he had a good look in the corner. Even Tyrone Wright, they were not going to play up on him on the three-point line. So just Martin, I get he has the hot hand right now. He just comes off of making that one in the corner a few plays ago, but just not the best shot there.
We're under six to play now, 8 seconds on the shot clock, and now we have a foul going against the Lynx. I believe that one could be on Tyrone Wright, and if it is, that's his fifth personal foul, so he is now done in this contest. And again, we mentioned there's a lot of them with four or more fouls, and Tyrone Wright is the first man to go here for the Lynx, and that's a big loss because that's a one-on-one opportunity now for Graceland.
Yeah, and he's not able to come back in the game. Then that crew's either got to put in Nesbitt, who has four fouls, and they are. So that's going to be another just a risky play here for Coach Lepp. Just, I know there's only 5:48 left in the ball game, but Nesbitt has a tendency to just kind of foul if he's kind of getting low on the block against someone. So, and his sheer size is going to be intimidating enough for the official might blow a whistle here for a fifth foul.
Martin as well. He's definitely going to have to be careful as, along with Nesbitt, as they both have four. As Person with the one-on-one opportunity does knock down the first, and that puts it back at a 10-point lead. I know Graceland's kind of celebrating right here, but there's still 5.5 minutes to go in this contest, and we've seen the Lynx go on a little bit of a run before as he knocks down a pair. It's an 11-point lead right here, and this is a game that was a little chippy down the stretch at the end. The Lynx did come out on top, but we'll see if they have an answer because they're going to have to find one here real soon as Gonzalez has that one poked away. Ball's loose on the floor. Nesbitt down low with it, and we have a jump ball. No, actually, I believe they called a foul the way.
They called the timeout, I think, is what. Yeah, the call is Nesbitt did call the timeout when he's down low, so good heads-up play there from Nesbitt.
You got to like that as well. Came up a little shaken up a little bit. Right now, though, we will hear a quick word from our sponsors.
The State Bank of Lincoln is Lincoln's oldest bank. In fact, its home location at 508 Broadway dates back over 100 years. That's 100 years of providing Lincoln and surrounding area residents and businesses with banking services, including savings and checking accounts. They also provide personal business and agricultural loans and retirement planning. The State Bank of Lincoln's Woodlawn branch opens mornings at 7:30. You can also find them at Walmart in Lincoln and with two locations in Clinton. The State Bank of Lincoln, since 1903, assisting and strengthening both individual and the local community.
State Bank of Lincoln right there. I'm sure Honest Abe has an account with them set up as well for how long they've been around here in Lincoln. 75-64 as they throw it to Nesbitt, and he puts it up and in off the tip.
I love it. Every time Nesbitt scores, it's just immediate, just sprint back down the floor. It's so funny to me. Every time I see it, just he gets so hyped up when he scores the basketball.
Now, who would you say has the better trot back down the floor?
Tyrone Wright? Yeah.
Little jog as there's a jumper good from Graceland right there, or Nesbitt sprinting back down the floor.
It's got to be Nesbitt for me. That's so much joy for me. That's a big old three for
Martin.
Cannot hit.
As Walker pulls it down, and yet again, Nesbitt, I think, could have came down with that, but he has to be careful.
Yeah, just if a little bit of contact there is going to result in the fifth foul. So, yeah, good heads-up play there from Nesbitt. Just he's not going to let them call that fifth foul on him.
77-66, and we have a Walker Jr. apparently stepped out of bounds on the sideline, and Tyler took it right away from him. That's how you get in the heads right there. If you can't outplay them right now on the court, you got to find a way to kind of slow them down a little bit, and that's the start that they needed.
Yeah, you got to slow them down somehow. I think Blake Maris just checks. He checks into the ball game for Winslow Martin. I think you got to give Maris a three-point opportunity. Going to get the up and under layup. No good. A lot of contact there from Walker, just not enough to call a foul.
And you talked about it right on cue. They did try to find Maris. Just up and under move did not work for him. Kind of reminds me of Lou Griffith, where it always pop in and out all season long. And does not mean he's a bad player by all means, just having some bad luck. As they feed Oliver down low, and he'll slam it home for Graceland. And still plenty of time, but that could have been the exclamation point that Graceland needed to kind of seal the deal along with the energy type thing. But Tyler drives in. Just wait one more second, says Trayvon Tyler. Count the basket and the foul as he goes to the line for an and-one opportunity. And just when we thought on the other end with the dunk, Tyler saying, no, not yet.
Yeah, it's not out of play yet. I mean, we're only down 11. Chance to make it 10 here. But with Latham Jr. kind of having a little bit of a cold stretch here, as Tyler does knock down the free throw, I think you got to go to Tyler. I think he's definitely the best guy on the floor right now for either team. So you got to go to him down, just try to get something going for us.
And now I think the shot clock didn't start in time, but.
Yeah, here's that Tyler layup, just nice little spin move, just hack, and the foul. That's a highlight play there for Trayvon Tyler.
One of many that this kid has in his career here at Lincoln College.
I mean, he already has, three or four mixtapes on YouTube, but just, I mean, look him up. I mean, he's had some crazy highlights over the years. It's a senior year, so.
How many times did we make those?
Yeah, it's quite a bit, but just, he's definitely one of the most decorated Lincoln College basketball players.
He sure is. Also a 1,000-point scorer here. The only one on the team is the double team. They find Walker to Coleman. He drives baseline, up and under move. You got it. 81-69. The Link's going to have to answer. They find Maris. Thought about a three instead. He's going to drive baseline, trying to bounce past one to the corner for Junior, but it's tipped out of bounds, so it'll stay with the Link's, however, though. But it seems like Graceland all over us right now. They know exactly what we're trying to do.
They have depth. I mean, they're able to go just swarm us every time we get it, just because they're fresh. They have a lot of guys that have played that many minutes here. I mean, Walker hardly played the first half at all.
As Crumble drives in, draws contact, and it seems like finally something went in favor of the Lynx right here. The first game, it was all Lady Lynx. This one, a little bit more spread out and a lot more fair, I guess you could say, but Crumble at the line for two.
Yeah, this game is – it's been really good. I mean, except for, like, the last couple minutes where Graceland's starting to pull away. But just the first half alone was just one for the ages. One of the most entertaining games in that first half. Just hopefully we can come back into this ball game.
81-70 now. Crumble at the line. Another very good free throw shooter for this Lynx team. Knocks down a pair right there. And the Lynx, that's how they're going to stay in this ball game. They're going to climb their way back into it. See what happens here in the next 3 minutes and 15 seconds. 10-point lead here for Graceland as they have the basketball. And I think if you're Corey Hoff's team, you want to kind of slow the pace down here just a little bit, waste as much time as you can as they feed Walker down low to Oliver driving in, cutting towards the basket, can't get it to go. But there's a foul going in the act of shooting. Late whistle right there, but we'll see who it is on. And if it's going on Nesbitt, it does. That's his fifth as well. So both big men out for the Lynx, and you're going to put in Martin, who also has four fouls.
I didn't think that foul was on Nesbitt. I thought that was going to go against Junior. It just – that's – he wasn't really in the play. So I thought that foul definitely should have gone on Junior.
I agree with you there. Nesbitt didn't even leave his feet on that last one, and you know he's not going to when he's trying to play with four fouls. Nesbitt also another one that has a lot of good IQ, but you can see Corey Hoff right there happy with the way round two has gone. Here in Lincoln, we spoiled their homecoming in the first game of the year. And they're looking to spoil our alumni night and all Hall of Fame weekend here in the Jack D. Nell Arena for our first home game of the year.
Yeah, just it's unfortunate they're both big men out. So Winslow Martin, he's going to have to play big inside. It's going to be a tough task. You know, Graceland, they're just huge inside. I think Tyler on Walker is going to have to keep going. I mean, as long as, I mean, he's so undersized. That's a big rebound there for Martin.
One of two from the line goes Oliver. It's still a 10-point lead. We'll see what the Lynx have in store. They need an answer right here, maybe possibly a three, as Crumble gets Junior down low to Martin. He's trying to double-team his man, and they're going to have an offensive foul going against Winslow Martin II. Coleman didn't even move. Didn't even fall to the ground. It looked like a flop. They didn't call the flop. They called an offensive foul. And here you go. Just when you thought that it was going to get interesting and you said the officials have been good all game long, that was the worst call ever.
Yeah, look at this play right here. I mean, yes, there's a bump right there. That's a flop. You got to call that foul. And then he just gets absolutely hammered right there by Oliver. How do you call that play? Now, Garrett Hooker's going to have to come into this ball game, but that's just unfortunate there. For Winslow Martin, he's obviously upset. I mean, Coach Leff didn't fight it that much. I'm surprised he didn't. It's a bad call.
The only thing that I saw in that with that replay, it did look like Coleman was set. However, though,
there just is not enough contact.
Right, though. Exactly. I know, I completely agree with you. I mean, I just said it was the worst call ever on TV. As Hernandez trying to back down his man, and he does now with the mismatch. I mean, everybody basically out for this Lynx team. The two starters and Nesbitt, our tallest player, and maybe our biggest player, strongest player, also out with
Crumble's got four as well. So, I mean, if he fouls out, what happens? You know, it's under 2 minutes now, but that's still plenty of time here.
And you're exactly right. I didn't even think of that as they tried to get another call right there. They didn't even call it this time around. 83-71, minute 40 to go, and that's huge. You know, I didn't even think of that. Crumble's got four fouls. Who's going to replace him?
Yeah, the three guys on the bench are fouled out, so, I mean, we're going to have to go 4-on-5, and we just don't have any guys.
83-71. I mean, I would love to see a 4-on-5. However, though, not at all. They're in the wrong direction as Tyler now called for a foul as the pump fake by Walker Jr. got his man up in the air and going to send him to the line. Now, that's only Tyler's second, but, again, team's already in the bonus, or the double bonus, excuse me. So he'll get two free throws from here on out.
It seems like the air is pretty much sucked out of the building after that Winslow Martin play. It's just unfortunate. It shouldn't happen. That's a bad call here at home. Yep. If it was away, I would be a little more okay with it because it's just like that's what you're going to get on the road. But
sure.
At home, that's not what we get.
Especially when one of the officials is a former employee here at the college, didn't even give it to us here in that one. So you can at least say that they're not playing favoritisms in this contest as it's 85-71, and that one's stolen away yet again. Here comes Graceland back the other way, and we're going to have a traveling violation called before the foul was called as Hernandez and Tyler having a little bit of words. However, though, I mean, if you're the Lynx, you cannot be happy about this ball game. I mean, this is a team that you were up by 21 plus at halftime and then got it. They barely hung on in that game, and now you're going to let these guys come to your home floor and beat you in the last 5 minutes of this contest. But Tyler trying to answer for three, no good.
Yeah, just it's not the best shot. We're trying to just force everything now. Just it's not going to work. It's too late. So it's going to be the third straight loss here for the Lynx, which I haven't seen since I've been at school here. I've not seen this team lose three times in a row.
And that's tough to say right there. The Lynx, you mentioned it, Adam, as there's under 40 seconds to play. That one's batted out of bounds. It'll go to the Lynx, however. But Graceland fired up in this contest. 85-71, 40 seconds remain here as the Lynx look like they're going to split in the two games and the first doubleheader of the season. I feel like Junior needs to be a little bit more confident with that and take that shot. Instead, he hesitates, does draw a contact foul as there's a cylinder call right there. So out of all these calls, the cylinder one gets called, but not a flopping call.
Yeah, I think it should have been a couple of them, really. Crowd's starting to leave the ballgame now. They know it's kind of over. That's going to be the first one good there for Junior.
And just trying to keep it close here at this point. The Lynx played so well on Friday night in that win against IU East. They had another golden opportunity against Indiana Wesleyan, who was the first game that they lost to, ranked fourth in the country. And then we just went on the road. I mean, we just didn't have it in Kokomo. I mean, you would agree on that. 10th ranked team in the country. I don't think they were better than us, but just didn't have it here in this one as the shot clock and game clock separated by about 2 seconds. So Graceland just trying to hold it out from here on out. That one's stolen away. Maris comes up with it. The Lynx going to have one more possession as they try to find Junior with 2 seconds on the shot clock. He's going to have to dribble into a three. He knocks it down, but it's not going to matter, though, however, as that's how your ball game's going to end. Once again, by 9, your final score, 85-76 in favor of Graceland University, a D1 NAIA program that we took it to them on their home floor. Unfortunately, they got us back, and they got one here on our home floor.
Yeah, they got the last laugh. I wish we played them again. And we're not going to play them in postseason. They're D1, and we're D2. So, I mean, we're not going to see this team probably till next season. But it's unfortunate. I mean, you saw Walker Jr. waving to the crowd just like Tyler did in their home opener. So, I mean, it's payback. I mean, it hurts. It stings right now. But, I mean, we got to do something about it. We're struggling right now as a team.
Well, we definitely are struggling. And like you said, I mean, that's just one of those things where, you know, we only have 8 players to go along with that. Again, some chirping going on down the stretch. But, however, though, we only have 8 guys on our roster right now that is eligible to play. And like you said, when 3 of them foul out, it's just tough to beat that down the stretch because you're asking Tyler, Latham Jr., Crumble. You're asking all these guys to play 37-plus minutes, and that'll wear on you down the stretch.
Yeah, and Crumble playing with 4 fouls basically for a whole entire half. So, I mean, it's he can't be as aggressive. I mean, Montez Crumble without his aggression basically is the defender that is just an average defender. But when he has that aggression, you know, he's one of the best in the nation. So, I mean, he just basically just takes away his superpowers on the defensive end when he has to play so cautious.
And that'll do it, again, all here for us. 85-76 was the final here in game number 2. The Lady Lynx did win the first game, I believe, 85-72. So awfully close scoring here in that one. Was I right?
Yes, it was 85-72.
Okay, cool. I was taking a wild educated guess there on that one, but I knew it was close. So both of them end at 85. Unfortunately for the men's team, it didn't come out on top. However, though, that'll do it all here for us. The Lynx will be back in action on Wednesday, November 13th at William Penn. So it does not get any easier for these guys as they've lost 3 straight. They move to 3-3 on the season. Again, that'll do it all for us. 85-76 was your final here in the home opener for the Lynx. Again, we want to thank the entire LCTV staff and crew here at Lincoln College again for a great alumni weekend. And we will see you Wednesday night in, again, Iowa.